5 minutes from now. What does the president need to say tonight? What can we expect? We've got a great panel assembled, CNN Chief National Correspondent John King, Chief Political Analyst Gloria Borger, Valerie Nassar, Dean of Johns Hopkins School of Advanced International Studies, and Lieutenant General Mark Hertling, former commander of U.S. forces in Iraq. John, let me start with you. It is interesting to hear from the White House in these advanced excerpts of the speech that the president is framing this much like U.S. actions in Yemen and Somalia, not framing this like U.S. actions in Iraq and Afghanistan.
And that is because of the great skepticism after Iraq and Afghanistan the American people have to any protracted military engagement overseas. So the upside to that is the president is saying that to cue people, no boots on the ground. This is going to go on for several years, but it's not going to go on for a decade. It's not going to go on for a dozen years. That's what the president is saying. So that's the upside, the president using that analogy. But some of his critics are already seizing on that and saying, that, to me, is proof that he doesn't take this seriously enough, because this is bigger than Yemen. This is bigger than Somalia. ISIS has now risen to not quite al-Qaeda pre-9/11, but they have territory, they have sophistication, they have military might. So that will work both ways, I think. One, to reassure the American people from his perspective, this is not George W. Bush's Iraq war. But again, the critics are going to say, Mr. President, we think you're already late to this fight, and we're not sure you
well,
take
it grand
enough.
Let me bring General Hertling on this, because, I mean, General, when you hear the president comparing it to actions in Somalia, in Yemen, and also, if the president is promising no U.S. personnel in combat on the ground, I mean, for a real air campaign, particularly in Syria, don't you need, if it's a long-term successful campaign, don't you need American personnel, forward spotters and the like?
You need some personnel, Anderson. It doesn't necessarily have to be Americans, but there certainly needs to be some American control and some advisory bodies there, too. I think the president compared it to Yemen, Somalia, and others, because it's a combination of a lot of these things. It's much more complex than Iraq ever was. There are borders that we didn't have to consider within Iraq. There's a civil war going on. So this takes what we did in Iraq, which, by the way, was extremely complex, the most complex kind of complex counterinsurgency that you'll ever find, and multiplies it by a form of about 100. This is very tough.
Really? Wait, so you think this is going to be, from a military standpoint, more complex than the war in Iraq?
I do. Much more complex, because you're talking about an international border between two states. You're talking about one state that's involved in a civil war where you literally have a Star Wars bar scene of actors that you're not sure who the good guys are and who the not so good and who are the terrible guys. You have a government in Iraq that's trying to build up on the other side of the border, which still is going to have some complexities with the Sunni tribal mates. You have a religious conflict. You have people selling guns across the border. You have those who are coming in from other states joining in as jihadis. So yeah, Anderson, I don't think of how it could get much more complex than it already is.
And Gloria, for a president who campaigned on ending wars, I mean, this is the last thing he had planned to do.
And by the way, they don't call it a war. It's a counter-terrorism campaign, just so you know.
Well, they can call it whatever they want, but I mean, this is an open-ended military campaign.
But to the last point, this is a very complex operation. The president's challenge tonight is to say to the American people, by the way, two-thirds of whom now support some kind of military action, there's been a sea change in American public opinion because of the beheadings that Americans have witnessed. And he has to say to the American people, we are going to do something about it. We're going to be effective, but we're going to lead. We have a coalition, and this is not open-ended. And that's really hard to do in one speech.
I mean, does it surprise you how the American people have turned on this? I mean, there was no interest in being involved in Syria for years, no matter all the horrific videos that emerge. And within a two-week period in which two Americans are savagely beheaded in very choreographed propaganda videos, there has been this radical change.
Well, I think because the administration deliberately downplayed Syria and Iraq for a very long time. We tried to turn Syria into some kind of a humanitarian disaster that the administration consistently said is tragic, but it's not really a vital national interest. We don't have a dog in this fight. Even if Assad uses chemical weapons, we don't have a dog in this fight. And in Iraq, we said everything is fine after we left. In a way, the president never stood up to argue why what is happening in Syria and Iraq matters to us. And in an ironic way, ISIL has done that for him with those two beheadings. ISIL has made the case why Iraq and Syria matter and sort of has jumped over the president and changed the narrative. Now the president is actually playing catch up with what has happened.
It's kind of poked a sleeping giant here, right? They've crystallized American public opinion.
There are a segment of the American population which says, look, after 9/11, there was this rush into the war in Iraq. A lot of people, very few voices were raised publicly against the war, though there were demonstrations against the war, but there was a drumbeat pushing this thing forward, and based on intelligence that was not correct. Is there a concern that there again is this drumbeat here?
But this is where the no boots on the ground part of all of this comes in, because it's the skeptical public, and it's people saying we don't want to get involved in another protracted war. But you know, it's easier to start something than it is to control it. And we all know that.
Especially in the Middle East. I mean, we've seen.
There are profound doubts about this president at the moment, too. And some of them his own making, where he said not that long ago, we don't have a plan yet. He meant in Syria, but he didn't have a plan yet. So as he lays this out tonight, he has to meet the candor, the credibility, and the details question. But if you listen to Valley and you listen to the general, here's the challenge for the president going forward. He says it's going to take several years. Well, he's relying on the Free Syrian Army. He thinks you're going to train them and get them up to speed to help on the ground. There are a lot of people who say, really? See that happen. And he's also relying on the Saudis again to do something. And how many times in the last 5 years have we said the Saudis have promised to do something, and then a week or a month or a year later we're saying, whatever happened to that?
General Hertling, what about, the Free Syrian Army, so-called? We've seen they have suffered tremendous losses on the battlefield, not only against Assad's forces, but against ISIS, against the al-Nusra Front. We've seen generals from the Free Syrian Army and allegedly moderate militias going over to Islamist side.
Yeah. Well, Anderson, one of the things that we take, it's one of our mantras in the military, is that we live by uncertainty. There are going to be changes. The only thing you can be sure of wherever you fight is you can't pronounce the names of the cities you're fighting in. That's the only thing you can be sure of. Everything else changes. So we have to have the ability to react to uncertainty. And just like we saw a force in Iraq that we trained and supplied and equipped and brought leaders to, we might do the same thing in Syria. And that's why I'm a firm believer, as I know many of my military colleagues are, is that we need to go slower, build the intelligence of this, get the right people on the ground that we're supporting. That may take time. It doesn't satisfy the American population instantaneously, but it's the right thing to do whenever you put America's sons and daughters into harm's way, and that's what we're considering right now.
It doesn't suit some cable news anchors, but it's absolutely the right thing to do. General, appreciate you being with us, or all our panelists as well. Valley Nasr, thank you. Tonight, you can respond in real time to the president's address by using Microsoft's Bing Pulse technology. Go to bing.com/CNN and have your voice be heard. We're going to show you the results live as you vote, and bring you the results in our 9 p.m. hour after the president's address. Now, just ahead, should President Obama actually get approval from Congress before he acts against ISIS? What do you think? I'll speak with Congressman Peter King next.